an original MCM production.
And now to introduce our program, Dan Federley of Counsel, Andrus Intellectual Property Law, LLP. Dan?
Thank you, President, past President Joe. It's my pleasure to bring Max Yela to our Rotary podium. Max is the head of special collection at the libraries of the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. The title of Max's talk, as you may remember from last week, is Why We Think the Way We Think. And for the reason for that, Max will explore how the book, as a technological device, has profoundly influenced our cognitive responses to the world around us and about ourselves. He'll also show how changes in book technology over the last 5,000 years have both altered and reinforced our ways of thinking in Western civilization. Max, of course, deals with rare and historic books in the great collection on a regular basis and has a special interest in media theory. So he is uniquely qualified for this presentation to us. He received his undergraduate degree from the University of Massachusetts in Amherst, his graduate degree from Simmons College in Boston. In addition to serving in the library, he is also an adjunct instructor in the School of Information Studies at UWM, as well as the Department of Art and Design. Outside the library, Max works extensively with the Wisconsin arts community, and in recognition of that work, he will be awarded a Wisconsin Visual Arts Achievement Award later this month. Please welcome Max Yela.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Dan, for that introduction, and thank you to the Rotary Club for inviting me to speak on this, what some people would think of as a very arcane topic, why we think the way we think and how we approach this through the book. Can you all hear me in the back? Just want to make sure that I'm speaking loud enough. Okay. Oh, look at that. It does change, doesn't it? Yeah. So on your table, in the interest of time, I'd like to tell you about special collections, but I've curtailed this by putting handouts, one-sheeters on the table about special collections, and you can feel free to look that over if you wish and take it home with you. Suffice it to say that what I do is to preserve, and what special collections does is to preserve original printed sources that are documentary of something that is useful for teaching and research at UWM in the arts, the humanities, and the social sciences. We are a public collection. This is important for everyone to know, that we are a public collection. Even though I build these resources, this is a public collection that is supported by tax dollars. When you pay your taxes, right? Pay your taxes, because when you do, then you actually acquire special collections and my services, and they're free to anybody who wants to walk in the door, and this means anybody. Everybody has free access to anything in the collection, no matter how rare or expensive or fragile or old an object may be. Everyone has universal access to these materials. We are open, we have walk-in hours from 10 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the afternoon, Monday through Friday. Those are our walk-in hours. You just walk in the door and request what you want or the services that you want. But you can also come in At any time the library is open by appointment. So my phone number, my email address is on that sheet if you wish to make an appointment. I do it for individuals, and you can also ask for a tour and bring groups in as well. So enough said about special collections. The question before us today is why we think the way we think. That's a pretty heady topic. Why do we think the way we think? And there are many ways to address this question, but because my own research area is very specific, I'm going to be using the lens of book history to explore this question. And in order to clarify that, I will be using an approach called media theory. Now, I'm going to try to condense this to 20 minutes. It usually takes me an entire semester to teach this. Right? I teach a course called History of Books and Printing. So if you want the extended version, you're all welcome to attend my course. I do accept auditors. This is a serious invitation. If you wanted to sit into my class, you may. But I expect commitment. You can't just wander in and out of my class. You must commit to a semester. And you will learn more about this rather interesting and arcane and heady topic. So what I hope to do today is to give you the briefest introductions to the concepts in media theory and why I find them so useful. I will focus primarily on the Western mind. I mean, there are other ways of thinking, but we'll focus on our own Western culture. And I'll explain how it is that we came to use the book in the West. I'll discuss how we arrived at our modern conceptions of the book. And I'm going to try to convince you that changes in book technology, and not just the content of books, but the actual artifact of the book itself, had profound effects on our cognition and how we tend to think about the world and our relationships to it and to each other and even to ourselves. Finally, I'm going to point out that knowing all of this, why would we want to learn this? Why would we need to know this? I would point out that knowing all this may very well offer a window into our own future. And that could be very useful, of course. Now, as a special collections librarian, I'm deeply interested in the preservation and retrieval of information. And since I work with books, I'm interested in how the artifact of the book itself might offer some insight about ourselves and about our past. In the 1990s, I began studying the media theories of Marshall McLuhan. How many of you know who Marshall McLuhan is? I just wanted to see a show of hands. Okay, quite a few. We're all of that generation where Marshall McLuhan was rather controversial in the 60s, 70s, and early 80s. When I ask my students that, they're like, that this blank stare. They have no idea who this guy is. And he was very prominent when I was growing up. So I was really interested in his theories. And I began to apply that theory to books to see how they, not the information they contain, may have affected our brains over the past 5,000 or 6,000 years, the amount of time that we've been actually embedded in book, actually engaged in the media of books themselves. So I'm an unabashed McLuhanist. This is what I really use his theories, and his theories were very controversial at the time. He developed theories in the 50s and 60s, specifically about electronic media and what electronic media, how it was organizing our cognitive abilities, how it made us think about the world. But he also applied it to all kinds of other media. And if you know Marshall at all, you know him from key words or key phrases that we often use today without thinking about Marshall McLuhan. The idea of the global village. He was thinking that electronic media shrunk our world, that we would know about things in India or China or Indonesia or South America almost within minutes, seconds, instantaneously even. And it shrunk our world and made our entire world one giant global village. My students have never heard this phrase before. I'm sure many of you have. The important one for us today is the medium is the message. This is his most famous phrase. You know, what does that mean? That we are so engaged in the content of media that we rarely reflect on how that content is delivered to us and how the content actually frames how we think about, how the media frames how we think about that content. To engage in a particular content in a film, let's say, is a very different experience than engaging that exact same content on the radio or in a book or on your handheld device. The information doesn't change, but the message of the delivery part of this alters how we accept and integrate ourselves with that content. The medium is the message. And then there's the most difficult idea, and you've probably heard this as well, this phrase, hot and cold media. It's really difficult to explain in one sentence. I will simply say that hot media is very rich, filled with bits of information, and requires less cognition, less active thinking. So when you are watching television, there's so many bits of information that there's very little reason for you to do a whole lot of cognition. Right? But if you're talking to somebody on the phone, there's lots of missing bits of information, very low bits of information, requiring you to fill in those things that are missing. That's much cooler media. In his media theory, he believed that media, and books are media, altered our environment. He believed that when we engage in a media expression, it extends our perceptions. It allows us to think in another way by thinking through the medium itself. And when we change that medium in some way, when we say move from books to digital environment, it alters our brain patterns. It alters our cognition. It alters the way we think about ourselves, the world, our relationships to it. When these ratios change, men change, meaning that when we move to a different medium, we ourselves are altered in some way, that we are framed by the media that we engage in. And he had this one phrase that says it all very succinctly: media work us over completely. And he means completely. You know, we think we understand the world because of our engagement in the world, and he really believes, and so do I, that we understand the world not through our engagement in the world, but through our engagement of mediations of the world. You know, mathematical formulas, books, digital environments, movies, photos, paintings, sculpture, all these media recreate the world that we engage in a way that we can see it in a different way and understand it differently. And that's why we think the way we think. But I'm going to use the book as an example. So humans have been mediating their experiences and their environments for tens of thousands of years in all kinds of media without apparently any need for books. So, you know, what happened exactly? Why did book suddenly appear only about 6,000-7,000 years ago? Well, just about 10,000 years ago, humans in certain parts of the world began first to domesticate plants. And within about half a second, historically speaking, that is, they did the same with food animals. They had already domesticated the dog, but around the same time they were domesticating plants, they were domesticating food animals. Suddenly, historically speaking, there no longer was any reason to run around looking for food. It was right there, well cultivated, right at your doorstep. This ultimately allowed for the development of urban centers with complex hierarchical social structures and stratifications of all sorts, and most importantly, surpluses that could be traded on a mass scale that had never been done before. And along with this kind of trade came record keeping and contractual transactions. When archaeologists excavate these geotemporal strata, they find plenty of evidence of domestication, bones, seeds, evidence that indeed we did this thing. And that's the historical artifacts that we turn to analyze and say, what happened at this prehistorical time? And they also found many caches of these small bits of clay all around the Fertile Crescent of the Middle East. Nobody really knew what they were. Some conjectured that they were game pieces or perhaps bits of jewelry. You can see the holes in some of these. They look like they were probably strung through catgut or something like that. All they knew was that these things were associated with urban centers in a post-domestication world and were consistent in shape and size over wide geographic areas. What are these things exactly? And they were found in caches together, not spread out over the course of an archaeological dig. So it took this very smart person. This is Denise Schmant-Bezala. I like to call her Notorious DSB. So Notorious was able to organize and catalog these pieces in order to analyze and devise a theory about what these things actually are, and which she did. And it turns out that they were part of a recording system for business transactions. Each piece represented some part of a transaction. Then in order to store and preserve those records of the transaction, the tokens were placed in this egg-shaped envelope called a bula. Now, the problem with bula, that's the plural, bula, is that when you put these tokens in there, you have no idea what's inside them, right? They're blank, so you want to prove that this transaction actually happened. You crack open the bula, and you look inside, and there's the wrong tokens. You know, oops, there goes that. Let's try this with bula, and so on. So instead of simply wrapping them in these envelopes, they would impress the tokens in the outside of the envelopes before sealing them, and then you knew what was in the inside of the tokens, inside of the bula, which tokens were there. After a while, they figured out, wait a minute, why are we even putting these bula in these tokens when we can simply impress the tokens into some clay, and that would be the record itself. So it was an abstraction. And it took a couple of hundred years to come to this abstraction of simply impressing some image into clay as the record, rather than physical objects as the record. And I'm not sure if you can see it in the slide, but at the very, very bottom, you can see a date span, and the earliest date span seems to be 37 BCE. And that corresponds roughly to this date. Does anybody recognize this date? It's the Jewish year. That's this year in the Jewish calendar. It seems significant to me that somehow this year is tied to the invention of encoding and at a time when the world comes into being in some way. So the Jewish year is calculated from the creation of the world. And we know that people have been around for tens of thousands of years before this date. But in our world, already text and proto-books are organizing how we think about our universe, that the world literally is created out of text. And you know, this is actually supported in all kinds of storytelling and mythological ideas about the world. In Jewish mystical thought, human beings and the world is written into the world through text, right? Adam, in biblical stories, speaks the animals' names, and then they become solid and real and permanent in the world. The naming of things and the writing down of those sounds were important elements in historical times. There is history, which we live in historical times, and there's prehistory. And prehistory is specifically before the writing of sound and before books. So books automatically orient us to where we are, and as our understanding is of the world that we live in today is through the book environment. Now, the idea of speech and encoding is important because not too long after this, folks began to associate these symbols not only with the ideas of transaction, but with speech sounds that we make when we use language. The origin of books is as a portable place where we can encode sounds into a medium of some kind. They were sound recording devices, and I don't mean metaphorically. And that's what they remained right up to our own Middle Ages. They were sound recording devices, not idea recording devices. To read was to memorize the score of the text before you and then perform the sounds out of the page. To publish was to make a public performance of that reading. That was publishing for hundreds of years, for thousands of years. The medium of the book for a very long time helped maintain the Western view of the world as a communal and specifically oral culture in the West. Right? That's very important to remember as well, because we don't live in that communal oral culture anymore. We live in a very different kind of culture that is individualistic in our own heads. and not necessarily oral, but textual. So the book established a way of thinking and reinforced a way of thinking about how we move through our world, how we negotiate things with each other, how we plan things, what our place was in the larger in the community at large, and so on. Between 3200 BCE and 3100 BCE, the first continuous use of writing appeared almost simultaneously in both Sumer in southern Mesopotamia and in Egypt. And these are the earliest examples of continuous text that we have. And there may be earlier ones, but we just don't have them right now. They're not extant as far as we know. And while these systems were very successful and lasted for over 3,000 years and used by many different kinds of people, the people who engage in these media use them for practical and ritualistic purposes. We do not derive our concepts of the book from these systems. These systems were mainly pictographic, logographic, and phonographic. Rather, we derive them from the people who first used who first began to use the alphabet to encode language. And that is the Western Semites, and specifically the Hebrews. In fact, the earliest alphabetic inscription has just been identified last year as being specifically the Hebrew language, which surprised me a little bit. I thought it might have been some other Western Semitic language, but the earliest extant piece that we have is actually Hebrew. They began to use alphabetic forms. Now others devised alphabetic forms after, in using cuneiform and hieroglyphics, but the Western Semites were the first to really use this. And they used the materiality of the Middle East. You know, here's a potsherd. This is very early Hebrew. The original Hebrew script looks like this. And they're using the same kind of materiality that would have been used all over the Middle East. But they also used papyrus. This is a square letter, Aramaic letter forms that Hebrews used to encode their own sounds, which we still use today on papyrus. This is a post-Babylonian captivity document around 400 BCE. And the important thing is that the Jewish response and relationship to the book is different than anybody else around them, right? The book became central to their identity, central to understanding how they relate to the eternal, to their Godhead, to themselves, to the people around them. It was the book that established this. They thought through the book, and books were very specific. To make a Torah is a very specific thing to do, right? To write a Torah, this is a sofer writing a Torah text, you must copy from an exemplar. He's got the tikkun next to him, the exemplar. You must not make it up, and every single letter has to be in the exact same place. And this is where we derive our understanding of the book. This idea of the sacredness of books, the centrality of books to our lives, was transmitted to other Abrahamic cultures, including Muslims and Christians. And in the West, which is predominantly Christian, we carry this with us to this day, right? The idea that the book has something important in it, that if we put things in the books, it's like making a statue, a really important one, that we must treat with some agility and treat with some care and some reverence. I've often started classes by taking a worn out paperback and telling the first student that's next to me, take this book and just like rip a page out of it, and they just cannot do it. You know, most of them will refuse to do this. Why is this? Because we think the way we think, and we think the way we think because of early on the Jewish reverence for this artifact. Right? But the text that we use does not come from Jewish culture. It actually comes from another Western Semitic culture, the Phoenicians. It was the Phoenicians that seeded the Mediterranean basin with alphabetic text, taken on by the Greeks, and then from the Greeks, the Etruscans, from the Etruscans to the Romans, and so on. The encoding of sound, again, into the space. And this altered the way Greeks thought so much that somebody like Socrates was very concerned about this. Well, maybe it wasn't Socrates. It was probably Plato, right? Because Socrates never wrote anything, but Plato always told us what Socrates was thinking. So I wonder really if it's Plato's idea, if it's Socrates' idea, but he believed that by encoding sounds into other media, into papyrus or into sheepskin, that we would lose our memories because the oral culture was dependent on remembering vast amounts of textual information verbally, right? But by the 5th century BCE, when Homer and Plato and Socrates were alive, Homer's epics had already been encoded. They were sung for years, generations, and there were slight variations in them, but now it became a statue. Now, when we recited Homer, we learned it from the page exactly, and it became solidified as a singular text, not as a moving organic text, as it always had been. And even demagogues, you know, before they were haranguing the public by speaking extemporaneously on a topic and whipping up ferment about the things that were necessary for the day. Right? Instead, now people like Demosthenes was thinking about what he wanted to say and then encoding that sound into a medium and then practicing decoding it from that space. This is a very different way of thinking. This is to live a scripted life, which we still do today, right? This was unheard of in ancient times, and it was the medium of the book that allowed for this way of thinking. We also changed the medium of the book, and even when a singular medium changes technology, it also alters the way we think. We move from a linear scroll space, a unidirectional way of thinking about sound in an encoded environment in which you have to, if you want to go back to some other part of the text, you have to scroll all the way back again. Those of you who read Torah in synagogue know that, you know, you get to Simchat Torah and you're at the end of this long scroll and you got to start reading it again from the beginning and you got to scroll all the way back. And, you know, that's a pain in the neck. So this was devised mainly, you know, through the Christian community, right? The codex, the same kind of materiality, but bound on one side, the codex, which allowed for a random access way of retrieving information. The form itself shaped how we engaged in information and therefore shaped the way we thought about the world. On top of this, the letter forms that we're using, this is the Western Semitic letter forms that the Greeks used. This is Greek text. This is a manuscript. This is a facsimile of a manuscript that we actually have at UWM. This is the Vienna Genesis, done in 526 CE. Notice this text. It's all uniform in size. There is no punctuation, and there's no spaces between words. This is the way everybody engaged in text for hundreds of years, because it's a score. You try to find the sounds, then you build the sentences, and you build the meaning. It's a very physical act, and people wanted to do this because it established a way of thinking that was part of society, oral and communal, right? This changed somewhat when, and I don't have time to go into this right now, maybe it'll come up in questions, when the Anglo-Celts and the Irish began to encode their sounds and or use Latin, actually. It was because they were using Latin as a liturgical language, not as a spoken language, that they began to put spaces between words. This was revolutionary. This is a change in the technology of the page. And they also began to introduce the idea of punctuation, which had never been done before. And they didn't stay put. They were great proselytizers, and by the 6th and 7th century, they were wandering all over Europe and establishing Anglo-Celtic monasteries from France to Italy to Switzerland. The city at St. Gall is actually an Irish Catholic monastery center. The little village of Bobbio in northern Italy is an Irish Catholic monastery center. And they brought these with them. And they were the great intellectuals of the West. When Charlemagne came to power in the late 8th century and was crowned the new Roman emperor in 800 CE. And Charlemagne turned to his right-hand scholar, Alcuin, who was an Anglo-Celtic monk and scholar, and said, you know, I need a single hand to represent everything that we write in this new empire. And he devised something based on the uncial, and this is it. This is the Carolingian minuscule. And this also, these are changes in the technology of the page. Separation of words, punctuation, and these letter forms, which had never been seen before. Right, that was based on informal hands. We recognize this today. This is the we live in a Carolingian minuscule environment, which we see what we call now lowercase letters and uppercase letters. It changes, you know, we have ascenders and descenders, and it changes how we see these words and decode them. Right? Suddenly we're seeing shapes, we're seeing forms like we never could before, and we're separating those words out. And when we do that, there's no longer a necessity to find the sound in these spaces. Those ideas literally pop into your head, and by the 11th and 12th century, the book goes silent. And this is the most dramatic thing in Western civilization, was that the book goes silent. We begin to read in our own heads, and it transformed everything. People like to think that print transformed everything, and it was really these technologies that transformed things. The modern individual is born with the silence of the page. Rise of cities happen with the silence of the page. Universities are founded on the silence of the page. And this is augmented when books are mechanized by Gutenberg in the 15th century. And people like Luther used this to completely alter the power structures, right? Use this technology and the idea that we can think in our heads. Heresies could not happen in an oral culture. You read a heretical text and, you know, people hear you. They say, he's a witch, burn him. You know, here you can, all, heresies become predominant. The church is disprivileged and the heretic is privileged. And we live in that heretical world today. It is the way we think. This is how we think. We think through our media. And we look, now we're engaged in this. And no matter how maddening this may seem to some of us, it incorporates all kinds of things that other media do, right? Sound, image, still image, moving image, textual spaces, and so on. What is this going to do to how we think? If we look into the future, if we don't know about the lens of book history and what it did to the way we think, this is what we would think about. Nothing. There's nothing we could say. But we do have the lens of book history. We can use it to understand how we think. And when we think about the future, we can imagine ourselves being embedded in maybe a three-dimensional textual soundscape, right, that will completely alter how we think about the world, how we think about ourselves, and how we think about our relationships to it. We can apply the example of book history to how, in the future, we might think the way we think. Thank you. Now, I believe we have some time for questions. The first question is right here.
In your special collections, what percentage are on digital forms that I can retrieve on a computer or look at it on the internet?
That's a very good question. So the question is, what percentage or how much of special collections materials can we find digitally, right? And I would say in proportion to the entire collection, not very much. But it's remarkable how much not very much actually is. So we do have digital collections that are based on our own collections. They can be found in, if you go to the library's website, and just right on the homepage, there's a place you can click for digital collections. And there are more than my special collections. There are actually two other special collections in the library, the archives and the rare book collection of the American Geographical Society Library. And we've digitized a massive amount of stuff, mostly things that nobody else would digitize because they're of local interest, right? So you'll find those in digital collections. But I also, I'm very active in social media. And I'm active in social media for our department because I'm interested in demonstrating why we have what we have and how we think about what we have. Right, and so Tumblr is my main access point, although we push that information out to Twitter and to Facebook as well. And every single day we are digitizing our materials and talking about why we have this, right, in a chatty, social sort of way, but I also imbue it with a lot of book history. So almost every single post has some chatty reference to, oh, isn't this fun? And by the way, it's printed by so-and-so, and the first printing of this really happened this time, blah, blah, blah. And you know, we do that in three paragraphs, and that's it. So that's the way to gain access, and I can't tell you what the proportion is. It's very small, but it's rich, let's put it that way. Does that answer your question? Okay, thank you. Yes, sir.
It feels like pictures and stuff work.
All right, so how is digital technology, the way we use them and the various shortcuts that we use, affecting how we think and how we move forward? And it seems like you say, we're moving in reverse. No, we're moving forward, definitely. That's the way I think about it. It's a different way of thinking. We don't require the punctuation anymore, right? It's like us looking back at those middle-aged folks who were using, you know, no space between words. What were they thinking? Why would they want to read in space? And I'm sure in the future, people will look back at us and go, what in the world would they need with full words and sentences when they could have used ideograms, you know, emojis to actually communicate? I have a whole book in special collections that's by an artist named Zhu Bing. The entire book is done in emojis, and it is remarkable how literary it is. I mean, it's actually really easy to read, and to me, that's progress. So. And Marshall McLuhan said that when media change, we lost something in the last change of media. And when media changes again, we regain that. He calls it recovery, right? So as an example, we've recovered, you know, the lack of need for punctuation. We've recovered the scroll, right? So we have scrolling screens. And it alters our brain patterns because scrolling is again linear, right? So it's a one-way thing. We've gone back to that. Is it better or worse? Is it counter evolutionary? No, it's really not. It's just different, right? So that thinking in logograms is not any worse or better or more evolutionary than thinking in alphabetic text. I mean, the Chinese still think in a logographic phonographic sort of way. At least that's what they engaged in their media. And you know, it's actually easier to learn logograms in some ways, or it's faster to learn that. And they think just fine, right? So it's not any better or worse, it's just different. So when I see my students before 5 years ago, 6 years ago, I would give them a break and they would sit down and they would talk to each other at the couch. Now they sit down and they're engaged in their little devices, all on the same couch, not speaking to each other. It seems wrong. But it's not wrong, it's just different. They actually give themselves permission not to talk to each other. That's important to remember. That's social interaction. And they're engaging with other people through a device, through the medium, because the medium alters the way we think. Question here, I think your hand was up first, and then back over there, and then over here. Yeah. That's an excellent question. So the question is, are books becoming the dinosaurs, essentially? Because since we have another media that we can engage in. I'm rephrasing your question. Will books cease to be published as artifacts because we have much more efficient means of storage and delivery of information? And it's true, it is much more efficient. The answer from my point of view, again, using the lens of book history, is no, it won't disappear. There'll still be a reason to publish books because books are an entirely different medium that allows us to think in very specific ways that are not digital, right? Digital isn't better or worse. Books aren't better or worse. It's just different, and we will want them, and we still want them. Why haven't they gone away already? In fact, there are more books being published now, ironically, than there were before the digital revolution. There are fewer titles being published, right? So so it becomes very niche oriented in many ways. But I would ask you, like, you know, when photograph replace the need to paint, you know, a scene, did painting disappear? No, painting became itself. It wasn't about depicting the world anymore. Suddenly, you know, what photograph is done in the 1830s, painting becomes abstract in the 1840s, right? And then photographs didn't go away because of moving images, right? But they became aestheticized. So it's another McLuhanistic idea that when you replace an older medium with a newer medium, we have the opportunity to look at the older medium in more aesthetic ways, and we desire them for those reasons. Television did not replace motion pictures. But when television was invented, the first motion picture academic programs were established. Right. So, and computers have not diminished television watching necessarily. We just have so many more media to engage in our information, and books are just going to be one of those media. They'll be used for very specific purposes. There's a question back here, and then I'll come over to this side too. So the question is, you know, the scroll that we saw looked rather fragile. Is there some way of treating that scroll so that it opens up? And, oh, there are, and there, that would be wrong, and it's been demonstrated that it was wrong. So early on, they tried to do just what you say, apply a fixture to these things, and it altered the medium. It altered, you know, how it worked, and it made it worse. It made it harder in some ways to open. So all our best intentions sometimes destroy artifacts. What they're doing now is to gain access to ancient scrolls that don't open up very well. They're using CT technology to scan, CAT scans essentially, but much more sophisticated than, you know, brain scans and things like this, to gain access to actual text without unrolling it. So that's the best way of dealing with them. Some things still unroll really well, but when you're dealing with scrolls from Herculaneum, for instance, that have been charred and have been sitting in, you know, hardened cement essentially over the course of 2,000 years, unrolling those things is hazardous, but we still want access to that text, and that's the technology that's used today. Dead Sea Scrolls, the same problems, same issues. Some of them are still pretty resilient, so the Isaiah scroll, the Habakkuk scroll, still very carefully unroll very well, and they're very complete. I'm going to go to this side of the room. Are there any questions over here? Yes. Right, you, sir, the blue shirt, yeah.
When do we go from writing from right to left? Left to right?
It doesn't matter. It actually doesn't matter. It's a cultural preference. Western Semitic peoples tended to write right to left. I actually don't know exactly why that is. And people in around the Mediterranean basin just prefer to write left to right. But you could also write, I just saw you go do this. Bustrephedon writing means you can write both ways. So one line will go this way, and then you get to the end of the line, and then you read this way. You get to the end of the line, you read this way. Bustrephedon means as the ox plows, to read as the ox plows. And that's another way of reading. And you know, some prefer to read from top to bottom, right? Right? Or a mixture of both. The Egyptians, when they had... a lot of their pictograms, you know, were figural, right? So it depended, and sometimes they would have illustrated books. And so if the figure was facing this way, you read that way. And the figure is facing this way, you read that way. When you have competing figures, you had text coming in from both sides. And you can read them in both ways. So it's a cultural preference based on the medium, based on the needs of the population, and so on. Is there another question over here? Yes, sir. Good question. The historic languages versus the book. Languages, so book and text is encoding of language. And it's very specific to language, right? Not to just any language. So that codes are, the codes that we use in the West were devised for one language and one language only. Mesopotamians didn't have that problem, and Egyptians did. So you only read Egyptian, so Egyptian only encoded Egyptian sounds, where cuneiform actually encoded a wide range of different languages. In the West, there were only three languages up to a certain point, three written languages. They are Latin, Greek, Hebrew, right? But there were a lot of vernaculars, a lot of speech, but they weren't encoded. And it took the Anglo-Celts to understand that, wait a minute, we have this sound is t in Latin. We have a sound like that. I wonder if I can put this and encode my language, my speech, into that space. And that's why we use Roman letter forms, because Anglo-Celts are really smart people, and they were able to devise this idea of this mental leap that, wait a minute, I can actually use the forms, the encoding of other languages into my language. Does that answer your question? The other thing about speech, about language, is that when books became mechanized, certain languages became preserved and other languages did not become preserved. And Martin Luther required, I mean, one of the big great changes that Martin Luther did, besides using the book as a subterfuge, is that he, in his theology, in order to be saved, you have to read. There's no intermediary between you and God. You know, you can't depend on a priest. You must know what the Bible says, and you must read it for yourself, which he believed very strongly needed to be translated into the language of the people, right? And in order for your soul to be saved, you had to learn how to read. Literacy in Protestant countries goes up exponentially compared to literacy in non-Protestant countries because of this reason. So language and the book, it's a fuller answer, I think, for you. I hope that answers your question. Yes, sir.
I have to admit that none of what you said today had I ever thought about it.
Oh, that's good. I was hoping to be provocative.
But looking at the very primitive letters that they had up there, and then moving to what we have today with punctuation and capitalization and labeling predicates and verbs and adjectives, it seems like we've arrived at a perfect system, and yet we have to go to judges to interpret what two people are saying. So if we... In society today, all speaking the same language in theory, still have to go to a third party often to determine what the parties intended to say. How do we know that what we're interpreting from 1,000 years ago is even remotely accurate?
Just through analysis. And it's amazing that we're that accurate. So language in itself is imprecise. Ludwig Wittgenstein, thought that we could be more precise with our language. We can actually really be precise with language, and he tried very hard to establish that as reality, and learned that wasn't true. Language is incredibly imprecise. It's not good for logical thinking. How do we know what things were like in the past? We have to create ways of thinking about those things. We need to decode things. I mean, Sumerian was a dead language. Nobody ever spoke it. We know what it sounds like today, or at least we think we do, through careful analysis based on theory and on practice. That's all. That's really all it is. Are we absolutely sure? We can never be sure of anything in the past. All right? So all we can do is look at the evidence before us and try to make up a story. So when I tell my students that history doesn't exist, they're just flabbergasted. It doesn't exist. We make it up. Right, we that's what history is. It's a story. It's a story that's told by careful analysis of things that persist into our own time, into our own present, that we can look at and then make up a story about the past because we carefully analyze these things. And that's what special collections is about. That's what I try to do. Okay, we're at the end. Thank you very much for your attention. I appreciate it.
MCM Production.